I want to thank our students and fans, and we finished, I'm not sure when the last time we've done this. Maybe it's recently, I'm not aware, that's something Jerry would know. But we finished the year number one in student attendance when people say it's declining, not at Ohio State, and we're very grateful to our students, and it's a student-run program, so we do a lot of things in the off-season to make sure we never not appreciate that. I noticed this 13 years ago or whenever I first had the opportunity to be head coach, that you're always talking about boosters and talking about maybe corporate sponsorship and all that, the people that you forget are the students. And so we don't do that here. With Gene Smith and our administration and our players and coaches, we try to do as much as we can. Every year we do a multitude of things with our student body. One's the practice, one's the community service, and then we always do that quick calls, and that's for the student body. And so the minute you quit being appreciative of the students, you lose them, and we don't want to lose them. So we're very grateful to them. Second is the fans. We led the country in total attendance, over 106,000 people in that wonderful stadium, and very appreciative of that, because once again, I hear about people losing fans, and we don't do that here. We try to do the best we can to show appreciation for them. Also, group of seniors. We have a saying around here, respect's not given, it's earned. And these seniors that we say goodbye to, even though they still have more games, came in as freshmen and lost 7 games as a freshman. Had a losing record. Excuse me, did we have, 6-7, right? 6-7 losing record. Had a bowl game taken away from them when they had really nothing to do with anything. And they come back, and here's what they've earned. 3 division championships, won 35 of the last 38 games they've played. 24 straight wins, longest in Ohio State history. Three straight years without losing a conference game, first time ever in the Big Ten. And the second winningest group of players in college football right now in the last 3 years. So the challenge I have for them, and the challenge around here is now go finish the job. The one thing you notice I did not mention in there was a championship, and that's an opportunity to get it done this week. So it's championship week here at Ohio State, and exciting times. Also about JT, talked to him last night. He should be over here some point today. Had surgery, it went well. He had a very similar injury to Evan Spencer that he had in the bowl game last year, and obviously Evan's recovered without any issues whatsoever, and so they're anticipating the same with JT. We love JT. I personally have incredible amount of respect for him, as our entire team and Buckeye Nation does, because of who he is. And the more you'll get to know him the next several years, he's just a wonderful young man that is an incredible leader, works extremely hard at his trade. He is a Heisman candidate too, and he should be invited to New York. And if he's not, then there's something wrong. He has Heisman statistics. I did a little research on that. Obviously, I got asked that question several weeks ago, and I didn't know. But he's got very excellent statistics, and he's a leader of one of the top 5 teams in America. So I hope that that young man is invited to New York, and he should be. We're facing an excellent team. Gary Anderson's a dear friend of mine, great football coach. We worked together at Utah, and what he's done. They lost their front 7 on defense. We just, I just had a meeting, went through it with our staff, and to come back and lead the country. I think they're leading the country. They're top 10 in off pass defense and rush defense. Very, very good players, but extremely well coached. And obviously, we understand that there's also another Heisman guy going to be on the field, Gordon, who is, Gary tells me the best thing about him, he's a wonderful young man too. So that's good for college football, and. We're honored to represent the East in Indianapolis and do the best we can to bring Ohio State another championship. So I'll answer any questions for you.
Front row, Todd. Kirby, what's the last 24 hours like? I'm sure there's not a chapter or coaching manual to turn to deal with what you've had to deal with in the last 24 or 48 hours. How do you cope with it, manage it, coach through it?
Yeah, been a tough week. Shelly and I were talking about last night. Last week we were told Noah Spence, which I don't agree with, by the way, was because of performance-enhancing drugs, had his career taken away. It wasn't performance-enhancing drugs. So that's another story in its own. But that was disappointing, a 3-point student who made a mistake that a lot of young people make, social issue that, and I credit Ohio State for really dealing with, doing the best we can. The good thing is extremely positive what's going on in his life right now. And that's a credit to, once again, our administration and not turning her back on a person. So really disappointed in that last week. And then obviously a young man goes missing. Then obviously we lose JT Barrett. Then obviously the tragic news last night. So it's, I told our players, you add in the fact you lost your Heisman preseason candidate beginning of the season. You had our captain not really, we didn't have our offensive captains play the first four or five games of the year. I said, you shouldn't be in this situation. So you have to really reflect upon how that happened. You know, it's not, there's not good fortune. The ball didn't bounce your way. We don't believe in that. We believe in a very extremely close team that leans on each other in tough times. And someone usually steps up and makes a tremendous play or says something, or like Mike Bennett has really grown up as a leader. So that team, you know, is all, every red flag's up. You know, every excuse is out there to not play well, to not win a game, to lose a game. And you have some really good built-in excuses. And to overcome the incredible tragedy that happened last night, this is a real challenge. And we're not, we're going to watch it very closely. I can just tell you this, extremely close team that does a lot of things together and cares about each other.
Can it work into your advantage when you almost seems to have a tipping point of adversity where you guys sort of bond together and it's...
Well, I hate to, when you use the term advantage, that's pretty hardcore. I don't know that. I mean, this is life lessons, and this is so much deeper than lining up on a football field. But to answer your question, you know, adversity at times, if it's a real close group, it sometimes brings them closer together, if that was your asking.
Yeah. Second row, Bill.
Kind of my question, but I guess there are two ways to look at this. You waited all year to get back to this point with unfinished business from last year, and yet now you've got all this stuff, I mean real stuff, that you're dealing with. Is there a sense that, okay, all this is against us, and let's go show the world, nobody believes us?
Bill, we were off today. You know, we right at the end of practice, we had a long chat with our players about what happened, and I'll know more tomorrow. A lot of the good thing is I see a bunch of guys popping around here. That's the other sign of a good team. When I first got here, Coach Drayton told me the one thing that you're not going to like is we're off campus a little bit, you know, the facility, is you're not going to see the players around very much. And I don't like that at all. I mean, I don't like that meeting room. I like to go talk to the guys and go in the weight room. And so we created an atmosphere around here where the locker room, obviously the food, that's a good way to get them over here. Really, you know, there wasn't the training table over here. We didn't have a locker room like it is now. We really didn't have a lounge area that the guys are, they bring their food in, they have iPads, and so it's a much different atmosphere where they're always over here. And the reason I'm probably in a good mood right now is I've seen about 40 players come popping through. Hey, coach, how's it going? And put your arm around them and talk about stuff. And that's what makes coaches' days. You know, when we're sitting in the offense line, I was walking around, outflying in those guys, that's what gets families through tough situations.
And I know that at Florida you've dealt with player deaths, and it's not an experience you want to have, but it is something that you've experienced. How do you, as a coach, help that process?
Great question. You know, I the first time it happened, it was a long time ago, and it was I called Chris Carter, you know, and he dealt with it when he was a player at the Minnesota Vikings. And by the way, I want to thank Chris as well. I asked him to come back and be part of it, and boy, was he part of it. He was at dinner with us Friday night. I made our players aware that's giving back to your school and your program, and I know he had some issues when he was here, but my gosh, he's all in, and he really supports our players and our coaching staff in Ohio State. But he dealt with it, and I reached out to some people back then, and it's difficult. I mean, there's no, like you said, there's no, you can look in the coaching manual, I'm not sure you'll find anything. But the tighter the group, the better opportunity you have to, you know, I know you'll never get over it. It's an opportunity to, I'm not sure you learn's the appropriate word either, but just continue to grow and stay on your journey.
Front row left, Rusty.
Urban, you said last week that even though your mom told you you were good, you couldn't be a part of the Ohio State of Michigan forever. I'm just wondering, you were a walk-on at Cincinnati. What was it like being a walk-on there, and what's it like being a walk-on now?
No, it was much different. Now, the NCAA, one of the great things they did is everybody eats. And one of the hardest things when I was a coach where, you know, we have in a team meeting room and right here, maybe you're a couple scholarship guys and that guy's a walk-on, he's playing a lot more than you, but he can't eat after practice. And, I mean, every dollar counts with these young guys. And so, you know, I have two guys, Joe Berger and Craig Fader, they're as important as any scholarship player on his team. Leadership, toughness, and they contribute on special teams. And I was sitting with him one day, who was it, Joe, told me that it saves him $3,000 a semester now because we're allowed to feed him. So it's much different. And the approach I've always taken is, ever since, I've always been, if it's between a walk-on and a scholarship guy, I'm taking care of the scholarship, or the walk-on player. And as far as playing time, as far as opportunity on special teams, because I believe those guys deserve that shot.
And a hard life for them simply because you get guys that are here because they love football, but they're having their schooling paid for, but they got other guys that are here that love football, but they're not.
Well, it challenges you. I mean, I think my experience is the opposite. Those kids love every second of it. They won't do it. You know, to say every scholarship, there's some scholarship guys in this program. They don't like it. They don't like it at all. They're doing it because they get their school paid for. And you try to not have too many of those or you're going to lose a bunch of games. But the walk-on guy, they don't like it. They're not playing. And I look at a guy like Chris Rock. Chris Rock does not have to do this. Chris Rock does this because he loves his teammate and loves Ohio State. And to see him go through senior tackle with his mom there and his dad, and I mean, that's why we do what we do.
I know you said you didn't know Costa, but I mean, did you get a sense for how he
knew this? I knew him. He loved it. You know, he loved it. I had dinner with him a couple times, and it just was such a short period to spend with him.
Second row left, Bill.
In the spread, do you have any sort of a number you'd like to see your quarterback limited to in rushes, or is that determined by what the defense does?
It's determined by how the game's going. You know, the one thing that obviously the spread, you know, and that conversation comes up every year. And that's something that, yeah, we like to limit. You know, I think JT in Braxton, and, you know, I'm trying to think from Alex Smith to Chris Leak to Tebow. I mean, each guy carried it a different amount of times. And a lot of times, like the scramble for a touchdown, I think that's what makes a great quarterback. Those are the Steve Youngs of the world, and that keeps drives alive. And the scramble is something that changes the game of football if you have a guy that can move back there. The direct runs, we limit those. Those aren't called very often. And then there's three ways quarterbacks run the ball, and not just in pro style offenses. That's almost all scramble. Sometimes they'll run a Q draw. So you have scramble, direct run, which is a Q draw, Q power, Q zone, which we've done before. And then the other one's a read component, where a defensive player gives you the read to pull the ball and run with it. And so to answer your question, there is in our own mind, but a lot of time that during the course of the game that changes because the defense can play it however they want to play it. Does that make sense about the three?
Sorry. Front row middle, Dave.
Coach, you're not an underdog very often. Is there any psychological edge there? I remember you talking about that in the 06 National Championship game, how you kind of use that with your players to kind of psych them up for the game.
Are we underdog for this game?
What's that?
We're underdogs.
4 points. Yeah, 4 points, yeah.
I didn't know that.
Will you play that up with your guys? Is there any psychological edge? I know you have a...
We'll see. You know, I'm going to evaluate how we show up Tuesday. I haven't seen, you know, we didn't really discuss this one yesterday. It's just got some things going with them on a Sunday. But we'll see. We'll see what we have to do. I think our players, once they get today, that's their big day of loading their iPads with the videotape. They're going to... Because we haven't watched them much. You know, we haven't played them since last year. And then... that was really the first time, but for the last 10 hours yesterday and today, it's the first time I've been watching them.
Stephen Collier, real quick. I know you said you were going to have a discussion with the staff last night. If something does happen with Cardale, something does happen with Jalen, would you burn the red shirt with Stephen? Or
hasn't been determined yet. You know, Jalen's in that mix as well. Jalen Marshall.
Front row right, Austin.
I asked Coach Urban after the game about the difference between reps for – a starter and a backup. So there's some periods where JT would have got five reps and Cardell would get three against the scout team. That doesn't seem like a big gap, but I guess maybe five reps. What's the difference when you try to manage a starter and a backup to get them action in practice?
That's scout work, and then at the end of practice is the most important work, and that's ones, twos, twos, ones, we call it. So the one offense will go against, like the pros practice, because they don't have scout squads. So you take the second team defense, and they'll card up what the opponent's going to play. The starting quarterback gets all those. And then the two quarterback will go run the offense of the next one. So during practice, they get like you said, 5 to 3, 5 to 4, probably 5 to 3 reps. But those are scout team reps. The big ones at the end of practice, and those are usually 15, 16 reps. It's all the first team quarterbacks. That's where it changes drastically at the end of practice.
Is there still value for Cardell having had a lot of those maybe sure. first team reps in spring or even the ones throughout?
A lot of value. Yeah. It's going to be his first start. Obviously, a really good environment. Against a great top defense, but it's not like he's not taking snaps with the one offense or understands the concepts, so he has very good understanding.
Last couple of questions. Far left, Matt.
One of the things in JT's development this year that you brought up, besides what we see on the field, has been his preparation and leadership. Where is that an intangible that, how big of a deal is that, forgetting the athletic ability, but where is Cardale on that scale, I guess?
Well, we're going to find out. You know, obviously not as detailed as – he's pretty good, though. You know, you have to ask a probably good question for Tom, Coach Herman, and, it will be, and it started last night. So, we expect our quarterbacks to prepare a certain way. Now, what he does on his own, that's where JT was very unique and the ultimate grinder as far as, the preparation. And, you hear stories – throughout, college football history and pro football history about these just guys that are gym rats and that's JT was. Is Cardell that type? I'll let you know. That'd be a great bonus for all of us. But he'll certainly put in a lot of time getting ready to go.
Does he have those leadership qualities, or can you not tell?
He hasn't been in that situation yet. He did in the spring. He actually did a good job. And he was our backup, which he ran with the ones in the spring.
Yeah, Urban, a couple questions. Number one, you guys have been sort of, your program has been sort of impugned.
Did you say last couple questions or last question?
Yeah, last couple.
Last 10 questions.
I'm going to monitor some people around here.
Right. Your program has kind of been impugned a little bit about the text message that Costa supposedly sent to his mom, reportedly sent to his mom before he disappeared and stuff, about dealing with concussions, et cetera. Are you confident? How confident are you in the way he was dealt with here, from the standpoint of?
I was told not to address anything, right? I can say this. I know that this is the best group of medical people I've ever been around, and I don't know what that, and the way they handle their business and the attention to detail.
The other thing, with Cardale, do you limit runs now that you're sitting here with him and a richer guy? As the backup quarterback, how do you kind of approach that?
Being great question.
But also going.
We've had a mini conversation about that already. That will be continued throughout the week. We have to win this game. We're not saving them for next week, the week after, not saving anything. This is a big opportunity to win a Big Ten championship. So we're still in the course of working that through, Tim, but that is that's certainly going to be discussed daily. And then as we get to Friday, and the game plan's in stone. And even during the course of the game, I'll watch that very closely.